Good morning. Could you please stand and take your hymnals and turn to page 596?
Thank you. And I'm not on. Now I'm on. Okay, sorry about that, Josh. I got an eyeball back there. Now we're on. Good morning again, everyone. Good to see each and every one of you here today. We're going to have a great time in the house of the Lord today. And then a little while later, we're going to go downstairs and have Thanksgiving downstairs in the basement. We look forward to that as well. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. We come here today to worship His holy name. Amen? Amen. Father in heaven, we do lift up Your holy name. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. Father, to receive riches and honor and glory. And Father, we do praise You this morning and thank You for Your goodness to us, the gift of salvation that we've had, to know that our sins are forgiven, covered by the blood. And Father, should there be those here in our congregation this morning that have never trusted You as their Lord and Savior, I pray today, Father, that the Holy Spirit of God would just prick their heart in a mighty way and show them their great need of Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Father, we pray this morning, Father, for the word that as it goes forth, that it will speak to hearts. We think of Brother Dew today as he's ministering in another church this morning. We ask Your hand to bless it upon him, that You will anoint him in that church with great power and great freedom to proclaim Your word. Father, we thank You for this church, this body of people that have assembled this morning. We come here to lift up Your name, to honor You, to glorify You. For without You, we would be nothing. And Father, we look forward to this time of fellowship afterwards, downstairs in the basement. We share testimony and praise of Your goodness to us this past year. We pray, Father, You'll bless the word this morning as it goes forth. These few verses that we're going to look at, we pray that out of these verses, the Holy Spirit will just preach a message to each and every one of our souls, over and above what we're hearing in our ear from the preacher, but we will hear the Holy Spirit proclaiming to our heart that which we have need of. And we can go away saying we've had a good Thanksgiving feast today that has come from Your word that has ministered to our heart. Pray for our nation this morning, Lord. It's in turmoil. It needs a hand of the Almighty God to move in our midst. We pray, Father, that truth and righteousness will stand up in these difficult days, that we'll not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that Christians all across this United States as well as the world will stand up for the faith that they hold to, they believe in, they've been saved by. We pray, Father, that we will be a light to a dark world, salt in a place that just absolutely rejects the truth of Your word. Help us to be what You call us to be in these difficult days. We pray for pulpits across this nation, that men who stand behind those pulpits will proclaim Your word faithfully today. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated. This is Operation Christmas Child Shoebox Collection Sunday. And I believe I've counted 42 up here, shoeboxes that will go to various places around the world, boys and girls, gifts, trinkets of all kinds. My little wife was up working overtime, just packing her shoebox down, stopping that baby down, getting it ready to go, getting in all she could get in. It's so bad that we have to wrap rubber bands around them to keep everything in, don't we? That's a good thing. That's a good thing. Some boys and girls someplace are going to be blessed by that. They don't have the plenty that we have in our land today. They don't have that. And they're going to get this shoebox, and inside that shoebox will be the gospel of Jesus Christ in their language, wherever this is going. And what we want to do is we want to pray over those shoeboxes. We think that's appropriate this morning to pray over them. Pray that God's blessing would be upon that shoebox as it goes out, wherever it goes, whatever boy, whatever girl. The Lord already knows. He's an all-knowing God. And some boy, some girl is going to get your shoebox that you prepared for them. Isn't that exciting to know that some boy, some girl, someplace, somewhere in the world is going to receive this box? When they receive it, I'm not sure, but they're going to receive it, they're going to open it up, and can you just see the excitement on their face? You've seen pictures of Samaritan's Purse telling the story of boys and girls in various places getting these shoeboxes, and their faces are just lit up because they're receiving something that probably they don't get much of. So we want to ask the Lord's blessing upon those shoeboxes this morning. I believe I counted 42. And I'm going to ask one of our veterans back here, Brother Glenn, our old Navy man, the only Navy man I believe we got in here. I'm going to ask Brother Glenn, right there where you are, Brother Glenn, if you would pray over these shoeboxes and if you'd ask God's blessing upon them, that they would bless the heart of boys and girls to whom they go to, if you would, please. Thank you.
most places have any water. Remember you just now, when these shoeboxes were for these little kids that are in this country, in our country, Georgia, we don't know, and they don't know what their lives are going to be like when they do get these boxes. We pray that you bless their hearts and help them to see that, you know, somebody else in other lands care for them. And we just pray that you let them know, Lord, that you love them. And no matter what the situation is in, you still love them and you bless them. We pray now that you just go with the witness, guide and direct us, and we give you the praise in Jesus' gracious name.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Glenn. Appreciate that so much. Today is also Food Pantry Collection Sunday. If you've brought something for the food pantry, there's a collection container out in the foyer that you can drop that into. We also want to remind you that prayer meeting this Wednesday night and choir practice at 8 p.m. right after the prayer meeting. We look forward to that. It'll be a good time. And next Sunday, we have Robert and Heidi Jonasy with us from Friends of Israel. They will be speaking during the Sunday school hour. The adults will be up here, not the boys and girls, but the adults will be up here at 9:30. He will be speaking, and then he'll speak again at 10:30, and he's going to be speaking about why we need to support Israel, kind of go along with where we've been in this series of prophetic things that we've been teaching on Sunday morning. It'll go right along with that, I'm sure, and we look forward to Robert and Heidi Jonasy. There'll be a love offering that we'll take. We'll have a basket out there in the foyer. And trust you that you'll pray about that ministry. I believe God's blessed his church because we're a missionary-minded church. But I also believe God has blessed his church because we have put a great emphasis upon Jewish evangelism. And like the Lord said to Abraham, I'll bless them that bless thee and curse them that curse thee. Well, if we take that to heart, we want to bless the nation of Israel, do we not, as a church in our missionary giving? Absolutely. And I think we can look as a church, as we look at the resources that God has blessed us with. We're not just living from day to day. God has blessed us tremendously, financially, materially, and there's a reason for it. There's a reason for it. Number one, you preach the word, but number two, you support Jewish evangelism and missionaries around the world. That's the heart of our Heavenly Father. That's why he came. He died on the cross for not just you and me. We'd like to think it's just us, but it's the world he came for. So praise the Lord for that. So pray for that, if you would. He's coming next Sunday, he and his wife, and it's always good to have them here with us. One of the things they shared with us the last time they came, they was remiss the fact that they couldn't go to the hospital and eat in Bryan. They like to go to the Bryan Hospital and eat. Can you believe that? A missionary wants to go to the hospital and eat. Not a lot of great places to go to if you want to take a missionary out to eat, but he really enjoys that. And he told me, he said, if it ever opens up, call me and I'll come back for nothing. Well, we're going to give him a love offering, whether it's for whatever, but we're going to give him a good love offering. But I am going to take him there Sunday afternoon and let him be blessed at the hospital. But so pray for them, if you would. December the 3rd, I failed to have this in the bulletin, but the young people are going to be meeting from 12 to 4, and you're going to need $15 per person because you're going to go and make glass ornaments. Is that correct? At Mudsock. Where's Mudsock in Eden?
Right on the main street.
Right on the main street. Okay, I guess I haven't been to Eden enough. But Mudsock, you're going to make glass ornaments, boys and girls, young people. Plug into that. $15 per person. You'll have a great time. Any other announcements that need to be shared? All the way to the back.
I just want to thank the CUWF. They put together a bunch of stuff, and the kids last weekend put together the shoe boxes. So I think we put together 10 or 11 of them. So I
want
to thank CUWF for donating all the items to put in 10 shoeboxes.
Wonderful. Thank you. Great. Anybody else? Any birthdays this morning? Oh, no. How old are you, Andrea? 11 years old. Wow. You remember when you were 11, John?
Barely.
You would walk that fast down the aisle too, would you?
Not today.
No. Any anniversaries this morning? Happy birthday, Andrea. Any anniversaries? All right. Connie?
Could you please take your hymnals and stand and turn to page 75.
Thank you.
I'm cool.
Dave Siegel introduced me to this song, and I just think it's an awesome song. It's called In the Presence of Jehovah. Before I sing, I was asked to tell each and every one of you, please stay for the dinner. We have lots of food. We take home lots of leftovers, so please stay. The name of this song is In the Presence of Jehovah.
Of the King. In the
Thank you, Colleen. Appreciate that so much. Junior Church, you are dismissed. Stampede. Let's look to the Lord in prayer before we get into the message this morning. The focus is on Thanksgiving. We've been speaking about prophetic things, but today we want to think about that which we need to be so grateful for. We ought to be grateful every day, should we not?
Amen.
We're admonished throughout the Word to be a grateful people. Let's look to the Lord in prayer and ask His direction and blessing upon this part of the service. Father, we come to You as needy people. I need Your help this morning. I need the power of Your Spirit to enlighten. I pray, Father, that You will teach our hearts from Your Word this morning, that we'll go away strengthened, encouraged, and that we'll hear the voice of the Spirit speaking to each and every one of our hearts today in a powerful and mighty way. We pray that we'll learn the lessons that You'd have for us to learn today. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. In Psalms chapter 68 and verse 19, Psalms chapter 68 and verse 19, I want to begin there. There's so many verses that speak to this whole subject of being thankful in our worship, in our prayer time, in our song, in our music. There are psalms that are musical, that are thanksgiving and praise and worship to the God of heaven. And we're constantly exhorted in the Word how we are to be a people that is to worship the God of heaven and to thank Him for His goodness to us. How refreshing it is to be in the presence of men and women, particularly, for example, boys and girls who have been taught to be grateful and respectful. Do you find that refreshing in the world that you're living in today? To come in contact with young people, especially young people that have been so exposed to this world by the fact that they go to school and whatnot, and they're around boys and girls who are like the world. But when they are in your presence, they have been taught to be respectful. It's their upbringing. And it's just refreshing to you when you're exposed to that and you're just blessed by it. There's a family in the church we came out of that their sons, yes, sir, yes, ma'am. And it's just refreshing to be in the presence of people like that. And I think this morning God is refreshed when He hears from our lips the praise, the thanksgiving. You know, we're so quick to come before the Lord and say, Lord, I need this and I want this and so on and so forth. Yeah, well, that's good. He wants us to petition Him. But He wants us just to pause, I think, and be grateful for what He's done for us. He's done so much for us. In Psalms chapter 68, verse 19, it says, Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation. We've heard the story of the pilgrims over and over again, how they came to our shores in search of freedom, religious freedom. I shared last Sunday morning in the message, and we mentioned it again last Wednesday night. There was an article that appeared in the Bryan Times, and this man wrote the article that out of what another man had said, and never really referencing facts, he just threw verbiage out there and he made his verbiage be his fact. When his verbiage, when in fact was not his fact, he said the fact that America was not founded upon a religious, biblical perspective. And he cited the Constitution as not being a religious document. Well, maybe it's not religious as you and I would think of religious, but our forefathers, when they came to these shores, came here for that purpose. And that Constitution was birthed out of the conviction that we ought to be able to come before the God of heaven, and we would like to have the rule of God governing over our nation, and the principles that are found in the Word of God were certainly in the framers' minds as they formed the Constitution that we hold to and believe in. So my point being in all that is, our forefathers who came to this shore, the shores of the United States of America, came here for this very purpose, for religious freedom. So I'd have to say that our country certainly was founded upon the Bible. And when you go back and you recapture the events of the journey to America, that first year there was sickness, there was death, there was cold. They came at a time of year when it was not a good time to come and land on the shores of the United States of America, particularly the place where they landed at. And what they experienced in that first year when they came in 1621 was hard. 44 of the 102 colonists died. They existed on starvation rations, but God blessed them. And by the next year, they were able to celebrate what you and I call Thanksgiving. William Bradford set aside a day, December the 13th, in 1621, is the day of fasting, a day of prayer, a day of feasting and prayers and sermons. We're not going to fast today, by the way. Feasting and prayers and sermons, showing gratitude to God. That's what these early settlers did. And then we know the story how Abraham Lincoln officially declared the last Thursday of November as Thanksgiving. Where did these pilgrims learn to be grateful from? Did they learn it from their culture? I think they learned it from the Word of God. They learned to give thanks from the Word of God because of what they learned from the Word of God. And they learned it because of their redeemed hearts. Their hearts had been redeemed. That ought to be the nature of each and every one of us, if you've come to know the Lord as your Savior, to be thankful to the God of heaven who saved you from your sins. The Word of God over and over admonishes us to give thanks. In spite of our conditions, in spite of our wealth, in spite of our losses, we're to praise the Lord. You know, when you reference this word thanksgiving in the Bible, it's done oftentimes in a song, it's done in prayer, it's done in praise, it's done in a sermon, and we do it because of the many, many blessings that the God of heaven has poured out upon us. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits, even the God of our salvation. I think every one of us here ought to be able to praise the Lord for something. And how God has worked in your life this past year. You might have experienced hardship. You might have experienced some tragedy this past year. I know in our Thanksgiving, at our place, there will be an empty spot where once my son-in-law sat, and he's no longer there. But yet we know that God has a plan, God has a purpose, and Troy is not in pain anymore. He's in the presence of his Heavenly Father, and we're rejoicing with him. We will miss him. We're rejoicing with him, but yet we can be thankful. There's things that we can rejoice in the Lord in and what he's done for us. Take your Bible, turn with me back to Psalms chapter 26. I have just a couple of selections of verses that I want to share with you that the Lord shared with me this past week as I was studying this subject of Thanksgiving. And there's so many thoughts and so many verses that pertain to this subject. But listen to what it says in Psalms chapter 26 and verse 7. It says, that I may publish with the voice of thanksgiving and tell of all thy wondrous works. Lord, I have loved the habitation of thy house and the place where thine honor dwelleth. I hope this morning that you are grateful and you are willing to publish with your lips how God has blessed you. But notice he says, Lord, I have loved the habitation of thy house. There's a place in the heart of this psalmist as he writes this for his gratefulness for the place that he goes to worship the Lord corporately. That place that has been set aside. He says, verse 8, I have loved the habitation of thy house and the place where thine honor dwelleth. I hope this morning that you're grateful for your church. I hope you're grateful this morning for the men and women sitting around you that you meet every Sunday that come and worship with you. I hope you're grateful this morning for the songs that you've heard this morning and the many songs that we sing and we worship the Lord with. I hope you're grateful for your Sunday school teacher this morning that diligently studied the Word and taught you the Word this Lord's Day. This place where you come, the habitation of his house, I hope you're grateful for that. I hope you just won't take it for granted. We live in a world that wants to take everything for granted. You owe it to me. I don't owe you anything. I seen a commercial on TV that spawned this thought. Everybody ought to have a fair retirement. Maybe you've seen that commercial, and I'm not going to go into the detail. But they go through a dance routine, and everybody ought to have the same retirement. Well, go to work. Get a job. Save your money. You know, yes, we help people in need, and we want to help people in need. But just don't use your race as an excuse that you owe it to me. Not at all. No, we're a thankful people. And the Bible here admonishes us in Psalms 26, verse 7, admonishes us to give thanks for his wonderful works. Are you thankful for your job that the Lord has given you whereby you can make an income? I hope you are. I hope you're thankful for that. Are you thankful for the provision that God has made for you in your retirement, in your old age, or whenever it gets here? You make plans for that. You just don't live your life helter-skelter and say to the world, you owe it to me. No, I don't owe it to you. Get off the couch, go to work, turn off the TV, and get a job. There's a lot of jobs out there to be had. I see them all the time. Factories that are looking for men and women who come and go to work. Save their money. Learn those basic things that you ought to learn a long time ago in your home. Save your money. That's an important attribute to teach your children that they have in their life. Just don't go out and spend everything that you make. Save a little bit. Then you'll have a little bit when the shades of life are being pulled upon your life. But as you look at this passage of Scripture, we're to thank God for what he's done. And what has God done in your life? Well, he's supplied your needs. He's opened doors. You know, it's easy to be grateful when life is good and God blesses you with bounty. Maybe when you have a nice home and you have plenty of money in the bank and prosperity has come your way. But what if there's been loss? Could you find something to praise the Lord for? Well, these pilgrims did. They buried their family members that first year. Many of them did. And yet they found reason within their heart to praise the Lord. We can praise him for our salvation. We can praise him for the hope that we have of heaven. I am so grateful for that. For the hope that I have in Jesus Christ, the hope of heaven, to know that one day to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I don't have to live in fear of the grave. Praise God for that. I don't have to live in fear of death because I have a hope that's founded upon the principles of this book. I have so many things to be grateful for. I'm grateful for my little wife back here. I almost didn't have her. Did you know that? I almost didn't have her. I almost lost her. Really, I did. I have to tell you this story, Betty. Bear with me. Let me tell you this story. She doesn't want me to tell you this story, but I'm going to tell you this story. I can't resist it. But I am grateful for this wonderful lady, my wife. She is a treasure. She is a blessing. But we almost got divorced. Did you know that? We came real close to getting divorced. I had a sports satellite a long time ago, 68 sports satellite, nice looking car, two-door hardtop, wonderful car, 383, move up and down the road pretty good, but it had one bad habit. It would backfire every now and then, and when it backfired, it would close the little butterfly on the carburetor. And when it closes the butterfly on the carburetor, what happens, mechanics? Ed, what happens? It doesn't run no more, does it? It just stops. Well, she was uptown Bryan driving that sports satellite, and I was working in the factory. And she got uptown to the intersection, and that thing backfired right in the middle of the intersection. Why, that Chrysler product, I've never had much luck with Chrysler, tell you the truth. I had one, he went around the corner, it wanted to stall for whatever reason. But this one here, nice-looking car, just because it looks good doesn't mean it's good. But it backfired, and I got a telephone call. The car stopped. It's in the intersection. So I said to Miss Betty, I said, well, just take the cover off the air filter and get that screwdriver under the seat and tap the butterfly. Now, can't you see Miss Betty out there in the intersection raising the hood, taking the air cleaner off? Wasn't that a sight to behold? And getting a screwdriver and tapping that down. You realize we didn't keep that car very long. I almost got divorced. But I praise God today I didn't. And I still got this wonderful little wife. We have so many things to be grateful for his goodness, for his blessings to us here in this world. And the psalmist is telling us in Psalms chapter 26 and verse 7. He says, that I may publish with the voice of thanksgiving. I hope you won't be ashamed today to share how God has worked in your life, in your home, maybe in your marriage, maybe in your finances, maybe just in little insignificant things of life. But the hand of God has certainly orchestrated and worked in your behalf. Now, there's another verse of Scripture the Lord directed me to, and I thought was kind of a strange passage of Scripture for Thanksgiving. But then as I began to read it and think about it and meditate upon it and allow the Lord to speak to my heart over it, I learned something else. Romans 8:28, you probably all can quote it. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. If you go back and take the time in in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, I think this passage of Scripture ties in with Romans chapter 8, verse 28. There's a lot of things that come into our life from time to time that we don't understand. And God doesn't always give us the answers to those things. There's experiences that you've had. There's prayers that you have prayed and God has said, no, I have my own reason, my own purpose, and I'm going to accomplish my purpose in and through you. And I'm reminded of this passage back in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. If you go back and read it and study it a little bit, the Apostle Paul had experienced a supernatural experience of being caught up into the third heaven. Now, a lot of writers have suspicioned when this occurred, perhaps at the time of his stoning when he was near lying there at the point of death. If you go back and read in the book of Acts and other places where it talks about how he was almost martyred for his faith, and perhaps he had that experience. We don't know. There's just various places and times that commentators will commentate to that. But nonetheless, he experienced this experience, as you read chapter 12, being caught up into the third heaven. And he was permitted to see things that the mortal man had never seen before, other than this Paul and this experience. And yet he says in verse 4 of chapter 12, in the latter, well, let me just read the whole of verse 4. He said, how that he was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for a man to utter. And Paul goes on to say in verse 5, of such a one will I glory, yet of myself I will not glory, but in my infirmities. If you go on and read this passage of Scripture, to keep Paul from glorying, it seems as if the Lord gave him an infirmity within the flesh. He called it a thorn in the flesh. And a lot of people have suspicion, well, what was that thorn? My former pastor always used to say he believed the thorn was his eyesight. He couldn't see well. And he would commentate at the fact that one of the passages in the epistles, he said, you see how large a letter I have written unto you. And the letter he wrote wasn't large, but apparently in the large print because his eyes couldn't see well. Possibly that was the thorn in the flesh. But as you read this passage, it's just a powerful passage here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Paul asks of the Lord to remove this thorn from his flesh. Now, that's an interesting thing. And we've been talking about that on Wednesday night. If you go back and you read about the Apostle Paul, very early in the book of Acts, this man was gifted with what the apostolic gifts that the apostles would have had to be able to go out and take the message of the gospel. For example, we read about the Apostle Peter, the very shadow of the Apostle Peter, men and women that were come under the shadow of the Apostle Peter, they were healed of the infirmities of their diseases. The Apostle Paul, there was instance they brought handkerchiefs to the Apostle Paul, and no doubt he prayed over them. They took that handkerchief out and laid it on somebody, and they were made whole. Well, that was part of the gifts and the abilities of the apostles. They were given ability to establish churches. They were given the ability to write the word. They were given the ability to correct churches. They were given the ability to perform miracles, great miracles, early in the book of Acts. But as you make your way through the book of Acts and you get toward the end of the book of Acts, all these mighty miracles begin to disappear that they would be able to demonstrate before mankind. Why is that? Because at that point in time, they had what you and I would call the full revelation of the Word of God. So if you wanted to know something, you read the Word and you believed God by faith. You didn't need a miracle to show the fact that this man was, in fact, sent from God preaching and teaching the Word of God. That's why they had these abilities. They could do those things. And I thought it interesting, as I read here in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, this man, we talked about it last Wednesday night, he was ministering. The Bible says he preached long. And there was a man, a young kid, sitting in the window of a third-story house, and he fell out and he died. And the Apostle Paul had the ability to go down and resurrect this kid to life again. But when you come to 2 Corinthians chapter 12, those abilities were gone. He had a thorn in the flesh, and he cried out to God three times to remove that thorn in the flesh, and the God of heaven said no. The God of heaven said no, no doubt, because had he removed that thorn in the flesh, Paul would have possibly become very independent of God and not really needed God, or could have been proud of himself. of his great spiritual status. And as I thought about that, I was reminded how that God said to Paul, he said, my grace will be sufficient for you. That thorn will be there pricking you, prodding you, being a constant reminder how much you need me. Depend upon me, and my grace will be sufficient. And as you go on and read in this passage of Scripture, Paul gives testimony to the fact. He says, I take pleasure in infirmities and reproaches and necessities and persecution and distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. God used that thorn in the flesh to cause Paul to have to depend upon the Lord. He couldn't depend upon the strength of the Apostle Paul. He had some mighty experiences in his past life up to this point that he could have reveled in and just almost commanded God-like in, like he would have done in the past, that he could have touched people who were sick and they were made whole. God never wants us to be filled with carnal pride. And I believe this morning God will sometimes permit you and I to have a thorn in the flesh. And maybe you're here this morning. You too have a thorn in the flesh. You too have that which, like the Apostle Paul, you've cried out to God for. And you say, oh, Lord, please just take this from me. I could be a much better Christian if you just take this from me. I could pray better. I could worship better. I could serve better. And God says, that's the problem. The only thing you're talking about is I. I don't want the I. I want you to come before me and to depend upon me every step of the way. And so maybe this morning you're dealing with something that besets you. The Bible says we know all things work together for good. What good is there in that thorn in the flesh? It's teaching you whatever it is that you need to depend upon the Lord. You need to cry out to him. You need to walk in close fellowship with him so that you can have that grace that is sufficient to see you through the trial, the test, the storm, to give you strength in that hour of great need. You need to walk with him. My grace is sufficient for thee. And when I am weak, Paul said, I've learned. That's when the grace of God will be its greatest in my heart, in my life. I don't know what's besetting you this morning. It could be maybe something that is, we would call maybe a besetting sin that you have cried out to God for. Oh, God, deliver me. He forgives you. But he doesn't seem to take away that whatever it is that just tends to draw you back toward it again. And it requires you throwing yourself upon his altar daily, depending upon him so that that besets you doesn't drag you down. Maybe you're in that pew this morning. Or maybe this morning you have a spirit about you that is a spirit of depression or a constant spirit of discouragement. And you've cried out to God, God, take it from me. And God says, no, I'm just going to leave it there. And why am I going to leave it there? Because all things work together for good. I have a heavenly purpose behind it. Because when I leave it there, you've got to walk close to me to have the victory. You've got to stay close to me to get the results that you need to get in your life. He says, all things work together for good. So thank God this morning for the all things. It's hard to do sometimes. Sometimes we don't understand why God works the way he works. But when we depend upon him, his grace makes us strong. His grace is sufficient in our weakness. Thirdly, this morning, we're admonished to give the offering or the sacrifice of thanksgiving, to offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving. I found that as I was doing reference work on this subject of thanksgiving. And I came across this. Now, all throughout Israel's history, they offered many offerings, ceremonial offerings at certain times in certain ways. For example, the burnt offering, the meal offering, the peace offering, the sin offering, the trespass offering. Right? They were ceremonially observed at certain times of the year in certain ways. And they were offered for various reasons. But the thank offering was a unique offering that men and women could offer, as I've read and as I've studied, at any time. It was an offering of praise. It was an offering of the verbal proclamation of their mouth, followed by a gift of some sort as a sacrifice before the Lord in thanksgiving for his goodness to them. Let me take you just for a few verses of Scripture here this morning. Go with me to Psalms 116. Psalms 116. In Psalms 116 is a song of praise and thanksgiving for the one whose prayer has been answered. Let me read just a little bit of that this morning and see if you can put yourself in the sandals here of the psalmist as we read this. It says in Psalms 116, verse 1, I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications. I trust this morning that each and every one of us can say, I love the Lord. He has heard my voice and my supplication, because he hath inclined his ear unto me. Therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. The sorrow of death compassed me, and the pains of hell got hold upon me. I found trouble and sorrow. Then called I upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech thee, deliver my soul. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yea, our God is merciful. Aren't you thankful this morning? Our God this morning is merciful. Where would you and I be if he were not merciful? I heard a preacher say one time, we'd rip a hole in hell so wide the devil would be 6 months patching it up if he were not a merciful God. He's a merciful God. He delivered your soul, as it says in verse 4. Verse 6 says, the Lord preserveth the simple. I was brought low, and he helped me. Return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee. God wants to deal bountifully with each and every one of our souls this morning. And young people, it's not just your mom and dad's soul he wants to deal bountifully with. He wants to deal bountifully with your soul. He wants to have fellowship with each and every one of our young people, boys and girls, teenagers. He wants to have fellowship with you. And he will have fellowship with you, and he will deal bountifully with your soul, if you'll just allow him to. He says, verse 8, for thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, and my feet from falling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. Look what it says now in verse 14. I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all his people. God wants to hear the testimony of your lips before him as music in his ears. Your appreciation for his goodness, for his greatness in your life. Now look what he says in verse 17 and 18. I will offer to thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord, and I will pay my vows unto the Lord now in the presence of all this people. This offering was an offering unto God out of the gratitude of the heart. It is a vow of our devotion that is publicly proclaimed with some form of some sacrifice before God. As I studied this, it was an offering of gratitude for various reasons. For forgiveness or maybe healing, your daily provision, your daily walk with him, the devotion that you've enjoyed with him. Have you ever had devotion with the Lord and there's days that you have devotion to the Lord and maybe not a lot going on between you and God, you hear? But then there's days that he just washes over your soul. What a blessing it is when he comes into that quiet time, that quiet place, and he blesses you with his presence. He just speaks volumes to your heart. Why should we give thanks? Because everything that we have comes from him. It's the testimony of a redeemed heart for what he has done for us. Turn with me back to Psalms 103 gives us a little outline here that we're going to close with this morning, this whole thought of thanksgiving. What should we be thankful for? Well, we see some things in here. First of all, he says in Psalms 103, and you're going to see this again, the offering of the sacrifice of thanksgiving. It's going to show up here again in just a moment. It says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. There is a call to worship here in verse 1, but then he gives us the reason why in verse 2. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, and then he gives us what it is we are to worship him for. Verse 3, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases, who redeemeth thy life from destruction, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercy, who satisfy thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagles. We have a whole list of things there that we have been admonished to give thanks for, to give this offering or this sacrifice of thanksgiving that has been mentioned many, many times here in the Psalms in various places. First of all, your sins were forgiven at the cross. Never quit praising him for that. Your sin is awful. It's in the eyes of God, you know, we like to make sin, we think of the immorality that we see out there in the world, and there's a lot of that. We think of that as being repulsive, being an abomination. Well, yes, it is. But if you look up that word abomination, what God says is abomination, you will find there's a lot of other things beside this immoral clientele that we see out there in the world. There's a lot of things that we do that we might not even think of that God says is an abomination in his sight. Sin is an abomination in the eyes of Almighty God. Your sins was forgiven at the cross. Never quit praising him for his grace to you. Never quit praising him for his grace to you. He says in verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, as far as hath he removed our transgressions. What does it say? Our transgressions from us. Aren't you grateful for that this morning? I would hope so. Notice in verse 3, he says, he forgiveth all thy iniquities. He healeth all thy diseases. He healeth all our diseases. We have things that come to bear in our lives that we go to the Lord for, and we ask the Lord to provide healing for. Now, we have the benefit of being able to go to doctors, but you realize God uses the wisdom of doctors. God uses the wisdom of men and medicine to provide healing. And where there is not that wisdom to provide that healing, God himself can provide that healing. He can provide healing up until that last one. And then there's a point in time that whatever it is for each and every one of us that will call us home to be home with the Father, whether it's cancer or heart attack or stroke or whatever it is, God says it's time to come on home. It's just like my son-in-law, Troy. We prayed and prayed. Churches prayed. There were hundreds of people that were praying for him. And the Lord sustained him for a long period of time. But eventually, he was called home to be with the Lord. But I'm thankful this morning that in this life, while we have our time here, he sustains us. And he says he healeth our diseases. And notice verse 4, it says, he redeemeth thy soul from destruction. Men and women this morning will go to hell because they've not been redeemed in their heart and life. But look what it says back in Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. Watch what it says here in Galatians chapter 5, verse 19 through 21. It says this, now the works of the flesh are manifested, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresies, envying, murders, drunkenness, reveling, and such alike, of which I tell you before, as I have told you in times past. Now watch this, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Now the Bible says back here in verse 4 of the book of Psalms, he redeemeth thy soul. When you came to know the Lord as your Savior, he redeemed you, did he not? But he is in the process of redeeming us from these connections to the things of the flesh that are out there in the world. Just look at men and women without Jesus Christ, how they live their life without any form of accountability. But when you came to know the Lord Jesus Christ, he not just saved your soul, he began to redeem you. He gave you a sense of purpose and accountability, and he began to clean you up on the inside. I'm grateful for that this morning. He saves us, he cleanses us, and he equips us to serve him. Look what it says in Psalms 103, verse 4. It says, he crowneth thee. He crowneth thee. Listen, if you know the Lord and you love the Lord and you want to serve the Lord, you want to be doing what he called you to do, serving where he called you to serve, and you realize that when you come to the end of this old life here on earth, one day you're going to stand in the presence of Almighty God, and the Bible teaches us that he is going to crowneth thee. He's going to give us rewards for our obedience, for our faithfulness to him here. Now, I believe that no doubt we will lay those crowns at his feet one day in heaven. We'll be so grateful for what he's done for us. But the Bible says, he crowneth thee. And then in verse 5, the last thing he says, he satisfied thy mouth with good things. Like what? Well, like peace, like joy. He gives you something to praise the Lord for. Something to praise the Lord for out of the very depths and recesses of your heart. He satisfied thy mouth. You know, we ought to be the most happy people in all the world. We ought to be the most joyful people in all the world. If anybody ought to run around the church praising the Lord, and I don't want all you to go out there and do that, because probably the neighbors think we went off, lost it. But we as God's people ought to be a happy people. We ought to be a thankful people. We ought to be a people that can praise the Lord. And you read here in the psalm, the psalmist offered this sacrifice of thanksgiving, this special offering. They would offer sacrifice and thanksgiving because God worked in their life in these ways, and they recognized that. And I believe this morning and this time, God wants us to do the same. The psalmist says, "Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits." There's a song in our hymnal that we can sing responsively or a cappella if we want. 623. We never sing it very much. You all probably know it by heart. What we call the doxology, 623. It says, "Praise God, from whom all blessings flow." Dear friend, this morning you have a lot to be grateful for, to praise the Lord for. I want us to just to sing that song through. Maybe we'll sing it through a couple of times. And stand to sing, "Praise God, from whom all blessings flow," because everything you have this morning comes from Him.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below.
Song we don't sing much of, but it's a song that our Heavenly Father wants to hear us sing to Him daily. Father in heaven, we thank You for Your word this morning. These simple passages of Scripture, so simple, but yet so profound that You would have us to apply them every day to our life, to be living in such a state of communion with You that we take account of how You've worked and supplied our needs. We thank You for our salvation. We thank You for the healing of the body. We thank You that we can be here and worship You here today, this morning. We thank You for the redemption that has come into our lives. Each and every one of us can look at our life. Yes, we were saved at the cross, but You have begun the process of redeeming us from that which we were entangled with, this world, and removed from us those things that had a grip upon our life. And then, Lord, we can praise You for the daily blessings that You supply our way again. Thank You, Father. Father, we pray this morning, should there be those in our midst that do not know You as their Savior, should there be those that maybe need to spend time at the altar, that You will use this time to speak to that heart, we pray in Jesus' name, amen. Take your hymnal and turn to page 387. If God has spoke to your heart, we want to give you an opportunity to make a decision for Jesus Christ. Don't have to get yourself all prayed up to be received. You just come as you are. And the Lord will do the process of cleaning you up, shaping you up. But you come as you are, and you present your case to him. If you're lost, you say, oh, God, be merciful to me, like the thief on the cross said, a sinner. If you have a burdens of your heart, be honest, be transformed, come as you are. If you're discouraged and defeated and mad on the inside, be honest, come as you are, and he will receive you, and he will begin the process of transforming and changing your life. If you just come to him, but you've got to make the first step. Take that first step, and you'll never regret it. Now, I'm going to encourage you to come downstairs if you haven't planned to. I'm sure there'll be a lot of food, a lot of good time, good fellowship. Come downstairs. We're going to have a great time together. Father, we thank you for this time we've had in your word this morning. We pray it's been a blessing to the heart. We pray it's been insightful in some areas about the things going on in our individual lives. And Lord, may we be reminded every day to be a thankful people, to thank you for your goodness, your daily blessings of life. Go with us now. Bless the after service downstairs, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.